New group, the No Escape, have taken an unusual approach to making music in the 21st century by finding inspiration from bygone centuries. As well as the usual suspects in its arsenal of contemporary musical instruments, the group has blended them with others whose heyday was back in the Middle Ages and Renaissance. Among a fascinating collection, they've chosen to feature ancient Indian bowed stringed instruments, the baroque guitar, the cittern, and members of the viol family. Mark Mortimer, the musician behind the No Escape, was inspired by seeing Jenny Bliss performing viola da gamba with the medieval babes and felt its unique tone would suit a number of his own compositions. And so he made contact with the classically trained Jacqui Robertson-Wade, a pioneer in teaching viols to children in Britain, and a first-class early music musician. Jacqui has recorded on several songs for the forthcoming No Escape releases, including Time and Tide, a beguiling piece of music that challenged her and took her out of her comfort zone when she travelled to a studio in the mecca of all things weird and wonderful, Glastonbury. It was an experience she found revelatory, and here she and other musicians involved in the No Escape discuss the experience.
Why use viols in this contemporary piece of music? Well, I feel that nothing is ever obsolete. Wonderful instruments that come from such a bygone era resonate as much now as they've ever done. And I was first introduced to the sound of the viol via Jenny Bliss, an incredible musician who's based in the southwest of England. And Jenny was playing with the medieval babes, playing viola da gamba. And I remember seeing it for the first time and being intrigued by this incredible instrument, which she bowed and plucked and made this haunting, soulful sound.
Working with Mark and the No Escape has been a tremendously rewarding experience. It's been freeing and terrifying all at the same time. For someone like me, who's a classically trained musician and responds to reading music rather than listening to music, that was a challenge. And I'd worked with Mark before on other pieces where we'd had a chord structure, so I could improvise around that, and that was okay. For this track, Time and Tide, it was slightly different because it was just a background that I listened to probably about a couple of times before I went to the recording studio in Glastonbury. And played what came out of my fingers. And that sounds really crazy, but I didn't really know what my fingers were doing. I was just listening to what I was hearing and responding. Thing when we recorded this was there was a bar, some beats rest in the middle, and when I recorded it on bass viol, I stopped in a certain place, and when I recorded it on treble viol afterwards, I stopped in exactly the same place, which for me was quite interesting. And then when I did twiddly bits, ornaments and things like that, they just happened to be in the same place on both bass viol and treble viol. So although these viols sound like they've been recorded together, they weren't. They were recorded separately and they just fit together. which was, for me, a complete and utter miracle, really.
Peter Daltrey is the singer on Time and Tide and the much-loved frontman with seminal 1960s psychedelic band Kaleidoscope. He also faced up to a similar challenge as Jacqui. Speaking from his home in Wiltshire, he shines a light into the technique he employed.
When Mark sent me the track, I was fascinated. It's a beautiful piece of music with some unusual instruments and a dreamlike arrangement which just flows from start to finish. Mark had suggested to me that I might like to try and add some lyrics to it. But there was no obvious structure to the piece, no obvious verses and choruses to come into. I played the music over and over again and still couldn't find my way into it. So in the end I decided to upload it to one of my music programs so I could see the track visually, I could study the waveform, and in that way I found an entrance, a key into the song, which allowed me to create some lyrics. There was an almost inaudible three-note guitar phrase which gave me the first three notes, and in fact the first three words and title of the track. And then the lyrics came fairly easily, it worked very well. I wanted to add the last verse as well. There wasn't a key in for that. The important part was where it ended, and that was where the end of the song itself. So yeah, it was a very challenging piece of music, but certainly rewarding. We cut the vocals at Mike's studio down in Glastonbury, and then Ivy added the beautiful harmony.
Over in New York, singer Ivy Vale was thrilled to be able to harmonise with Peter, albeit remotely across the ocean. While he laid down his voice in Somerset, Ivy sang her parts in The Big Apple.
How did I get involved with Time and Tide? Basically, I heard Peter Daltrey was involved in the No Escape project, and I said to Mark, you know, is there any way I could sing on a track with Peter Daltrey? Because that would be a dream come true for me. I've been a Kaleidoscope and Fairfield Parlour fan for a very long time. And, you know, I would sell my soul. Thing that happened was Time and Tide arrived in my inbox, and it is absolutely beautiful, haunting, exquisite piece of music, and very, very Peter. I heard kind of a dark harmony part right away in my head, and I recorded it in our New York City studio, so there we were in New York, and I was singing with Peter. Through the magic of technology. It's an eerie piece, and I think it will stay with you when you hear it. And it's also very much a piece for our times. So thank you, Peter, for writing such a great song.
A man familiar with introducing early musical instruments into the world of pop is Michael Tyack, the charismatic leader of Circulus, who mixed contemporary and medieval instruments such as lute, cittern, krumhorn, and the rauschpfeife. Michael is an accomplished Baroque and Renaissance musician in his own right, but as a key member of the No Escape project, contributes cittern and Baroque guitar parts to Time and Tide, and hosted Peter, Mark, and Jacqui at his recording facility within the shadow of Glastonbury Abbey.
Well, I've always loved ancient instruments ever since I first heard pentangle, and I think most of my favourite records from the 60s and 70s tend to use harpsichords and things, because this, the sound of the harpsichord stretches back throughout history and time and all ages and all our lives, and it pulls this great net of time, and you're pulling this net back into the present moment. So it adds a depth that I just really love, historical instruments and bringing it into the psychedelic picture of the psychedelic dream. I walked into a cafe on Glastonbury High Street last year, and sitting there was Mark Mortimer with another chap. I didn't know who this chap was, and we were chatting for 5 or 10 minutes, and then the penny dropped and my jaw dropped when I realised that it was Peter Daltrey. Oh my God. So, Peter came, we walked around the corner, and I recorded him singing in my little studio, and we kind of came up with this, well, it was a very fluid bit of music that wasn't really based on anything, no particular time signature, and Peter just laid down this fantastic vocal, and I was, you know, very happy, and as a result, the track Time and Tide just came from nowhere. And I'm very proud to have had the chance to meet and record Peter and everybody else, you know, that played on that recording. And it's quite a strange little story of modern times, perhaps, and how everything is fluid, and it seems to be summing up some kind of, it's like a lament at the end of days, because everyone's feeling a little bit end of days at the moment. Perhaps we are approaching the end of time, and the tide of time will one day cease for us all. So it's quite a mysterious song.
For me, using these beautiful older instruments like the cittern, the viola da gamba, the pardessu, the treble viol, the baroque guitar, and the Indian bowed strings like the Dilrubar Esraj, etc. All these instruments that really held sway many centuries ago. I felt that using them, if it can help breathe new life into them and introduce them to a wider audience, then that's a great thing, because they're wonderful, wonderful tools, wonderful sonic tools. And they deserve their time again.
The woman who inspired Mark to use viols within a modern context is Jenny Bliss, the critically acclaimed baroque violinist, viol player and singer.
I'm here with Jenny Bliss and Will Kramer, and they've very kindly taken some time out of recording to answer a question I've always had about an instrument that features in your music, Jenny, the viola da gamba. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us some more about this instrument?
Mm-hmm. Well, I first came across the instrument in the film Tille Matin du Monde, which is about the French baroque composer Marin Marais. And I just fell in love with the sound of the instrument. I found it so moving and evocative. The rich, deep timbres and the exquisite, subtle details you can get with the baroque bow. And I thought, I've got to play this instrument. So I managed to get one. And then I started to improvise in different historical styles. And now I live in Glastonbury and I write my own music, and it's such a great instrument for accompanying songs, because you can pluck and play chords but also bow and play melodies like high, almost in the violin range, and also play bass lines as well. So yeah, it's a really versatile instrument. And recently I met William, and he plays a lot of psychedelic music. So
the gamba is a very remarkable instrument, and I've played it a little bit myself. It's tuned the same way as a Renaissance lute. So anyone that can get their hands around the chords of an Elizabethan lute can play the viola da gamba, really. It's just like, it's like bowing a lute. And you, it's like a cello that you can play chords on. So you can sweep around and sweep your way through these chords, like arpeggios from high to low or low to high. And it's a great shame that it didn't really survive as an instrument. It got superseded by the cello, which is just a single line melody instrument. And the good old viola da gamba, with its mournful arpeggioing through the chords, was a forgotten musical texture. And anyone that's not seen the film Tous les matins du monde, I highly recommend that, with Gérard Depardieu, because this is about a viol player, French viol player, and you can really get a good insight into the instrument. And the
there's no turning back. All the ones we loved, all the debts we owe, done and dusted as the seasons come and go. Done and dusted as the seasons come.